Today we'll be presenting on the data foundation that powers some of the data science and algorithm innovations in the studio creative production space. In the spirit of inclusion, we decided to keep this high level and approachable for any data practitioner who wants to learn more about some of the possibility that you unlock by digitizing the data generated throughout the process of filmmaking and content distribution. With that, before we dive deep into what we will be presenting, I just want to introduce myself and my co-presenter, Aman. We've both been at Netflix for 4+ years. Aman has been here. Aman just recently had his 5-year anniversary. Hooray. And we work under the horizontal team that spans both the studio and creative production space. The difference you can think between our two spaces is while my day-to-day involves collecting data across the Netflix studio, which involves the production of branded Netflix shows, my colleague Aman work across our creative production space where every title, both branded and non-branded, are prepared for launch onto service for our members. What does this mean for you, you might ask? This means that for any questions around how the production of the new Avatar movie is doing or how much visual effects budget we actually spent on the Demogorgon, I would probably be most well-equipped to help answer that. So feel free to pin me offline. For questions around when or why Netflix doesn't have any subs or dubs in your preferred language, Aman will probably be the best person here to help actually explain why that is the case. So the movie making process at Netflix. So for the past century, the entertainment industry has really captivated the audience worldwide with a lot of movies and mesmerizing performances. With the power of data, we have the opportunity to revolutionize filmmaking and make it more efficient, inclusive, and tailored to the diverse taste of our 200 million plus global audience. Here, imagine a world where throughout the pitch to play process, we no longer rely on the guesswork or hunches when it comes to the localization of our content for our members. And instead, we can harness the vast reservoir of data at our disposal to make informed decisions that resonate with our diverse membership. So picture, The Witcher has entered pre-production. With our data-driven system, we could analyze our extensive catalog and identify patterns and preferences based on member viewing habits and geographical locations. With this information, we can precisely determine which language requires translation for optimal accessibility and engagement across our entire catalog. What this entails is no longer do our studio and creative production partners rely on their vague estimations and historical precedents. We could arm them with actionable insights that could shape the fabric of how we do storytelling around the world. So let us now embark on the survey of the data we collect across the content production space, which, as I've alluded to earlier, we call it the pitch to play pipeline at Netflix, and show how we are looking to transform the business of making films into a more efficient, dynamic, and globally interconnected space.
Thank you, Dao. With that, what are the different categories of data that we are working on this, you know, pitch to play pipeline in the context of studio and creative production? We have business data, financial data, and media data. The business data is mainly focused on talent, vendors, production, and deals. What that means is, what is the content that we are producing, and who are the talents that are basically involved in the creation of the content, and what are the contractual agreements signed between Netflix and our creative partners? These contractual agreements are called deals, and we basically try to answer questions such as, when and where are we able to kind of show the title, and for how long are we going to show the title? What are the negotiated agreements between Netflix and the creative partners. We try to find this data set on the business aspect. The next one is the financial data. We have the content forecast data, how much we plan to spend on the content, what is the production cost, basically production budget and production actual cost, what is the tax residuals, and what is the content amortization. Finally, we have the media asset. Media asset in the context of the audio and video files that are created during production stage, as well as the music and effects, the subs or the secondary audio, and the time text assets that are created during the localization phase. These are the broad categories of data that we look into from pitch to play on the studio and creative production side. I know most of the presentations so far has been mostly focused on streaming. We deal with billions of data on the streaming side. On the studio and creative production side, we still use these billions of records that we get into our data warehouse. However, the nature of data that we deal with is really complex. Think of it as very wide dimensions that has variety of data, and with velocity of change of this dimensioning, you know, dimensions happening every day. This is the type of data that we deal with on the studio and creative production side. On the next slides, Dao, my colleague Dao, will deep dive into the studio production, and then I'll come back and talk about the creative production aspect of pitch to play pipeline. Back to you, Dao.
Thank you, Aman. So now we will start with the studio production domain. What you might ask, what that means. So here we have the same pitch to play, pipeline. And studio production is where the filming magic happens. So right now I'm sitting in Edit Bay where things are getting recorded. And that will be something that we would do in the process of studio production. And this is what it represents, which in here is really the three phases that we are talking about: pre-production, production, and post-production. So to start, we'll talk about the pitch. So a pitch could be a video game, a book, or a comic, In this case, we will use The Witcher as an example. Once The Witcher has been greenlit by our content executives, negotiations are started to make deals with real writers, directors, and other real creatives to start developing the pitch from an idea to something our studio could film. Usually that entails writing a script. Once the script is completed and approved, pre-production can actually begin, and that's when we actually enter the studio production realm. Here in pre-production, once the script has been finalized, this is when all the planning for the production starts. And that entails scouting out the locations where we'll be filming, finding the right actors to cast for the actual content, and creating a production schedule that enables all of the various studio departments to efficiently produce the content. Once the planning phase is done, production phase actually starts. This is where the actual filming of the movie takes place. This could take several months, depending on the complexity of the project. During this phase, the director and the production team work with the actors to bring the script that has been planned to life. Once the footage has actually been filmed, that's when post-production starts. In the post-production phase, this involves the editing of the footages, adding visual effects, creating final sound mixes, and other media that will actually ultimately end up on our service. So now that I've talked about how studio production the studio production process, we can start from the very beginning. Almost all productions start with a script. This is a document that really helps inform everything throughout the production life cycle, from budget and the size of the production, based on the number of scenes, the prompts and characters that are necessary to be filmed, the production schedule, based on the location and time frame that is set in the script, the subtitle and dubbing effort further downstream that Aman, my colleague, will talk about later on, in terms of actually using the dialogue on the script to inform those efforts. And lastly, creative insights around sensitive content, rating, and production complexity that really help inform the type of planning that we will need to do to actually make a show. Now, here I have an example of a script. And as you can see here, it's a very large Word document, which you might think is fairly difficult to parse and make into structured data. There is a very low signal to noise ratio here, which is great for any type of ML innovation. However, the script by itself is too long of a text to feed directly into any machine learning model. It's also not really obvious how you can encode all this information. However, as we learn more about the format of a script, it became clear that even though it's a large Word document, it is actually very structured. And what do I mean by structure? So here are some common structural parts that's related to a script. You have a character, which based on the indentation of the script, you can actually identify and parse out. The dialogue, which you can see here, is on a separate indentation from the character. The action, which again is on a very separate indentation. Dialogue cue, shot cue, page number, scene, and character description. So this actually makes script a very, very structured document. And across most of Hollywood, there is a very standardized format for writing this. So every indentation, every line is actually fairly important. But this then enables us to actually parse the data and build a structured data set out of this for ML innovations downstream. Now, why do we care? Well, in the pre-production phase of where we plan out how we, where our studio stakeholders plan out how they would produce this show, every department in studio does the script breakdown process where they annotate and highlight different sections of the script and add notes and other types of tags which inform the type of resourcing as well as planning that's necessary to produce a show. So here I showed the digitized version of a VFX producer who marks up a script document, in this case Ozark, and highlights individual scenes and passages where visual effects treatment will likely be needed. Doing this in the pre-production process really helps inform the post-production resourcing needs and make sure that Netflix, as a studio, can secure the correct amount of resource so that we can produce this content on time and efficiently for launch. With this data, here is one use case where we're able to leverage this data to build an AI breakdown assistant for scripts. The keep the lights on benefit here is that this helps save production significant amount of manual work. And when you multiply that by every studio department across all of our productions where we have a high touch, this actually becomes quite a lot of manual hours saved. A surprising side effect is due to the amount of time studio teams could save, they are naturally standardizing their own department taxonomy and script breakdown processes, which greatly benefits the metric engineering efforts that our analytics engineering partners are doing downstream to measure the production complexity of a specific show. Another unexpected benefit is by title managers attempting to standardize their script processes, our studio partners are able to make more accurate budget estimations early on in the production process. Lastly, by digitizing this whole entire script breakdown process and building this AI assistant, we are able to share and connect the data across different studio departments without suffering the massive pain of going through multiple email threads and different versions of Google Sheets as a way to actually figure out what you're trying to plan for, which has reduced a lot of confusion around our stakeholders might have when they're managing 5 shows on Netflix instead of the 1 show they might have managed in other studios. Once a script has been broken down and finalized, and all the appropriate production departments, such as visual effects, legal, physical production, has weighed in for the pre-production planning process, we now enter the media generation phase of the pitch to play pipeline. This phase encompasses both the production and post-production workflows in the studio production domain. In the production media workflow on top, footages are uploaded, offloaded from a camera, then transported to a dailies facility where footages are quality controlled for technical issues and rendered for creative review by directors, Netflix executives, and the editorial department. Once these footages have passed the production creative review process and blessed by our editorial team, they are then sent to the post-production picture work, which is the bottom of this diagram. Here, visual effects, color, and online treatments are applied to the media, which is then mastered and set into a coherent narrative to be sent for final quality control downstream in creative production. Throughout these media processes, many derivative media files are generated, millions of proxies, very expensive. And the descriptive data, as well as the media themselves, are then collected and made available to Netflix and ML practitioners for some of the innovations I'll highlight in the next slide. Here are 2 examples. The one on the left is more of a micro-focused on unblocking individual productions, while the one on the right is more focused on the macroeconomics of managing a slate of productions. So to the left, my data science colleagues have built a visual effects shot classifier that enables our title managers to more accurately identify which scenes will likely require visual effects treatment early on in the pre-production process. This enables more accurate planning, scheduling, and staffing when the camera footage is mastered and turned over to post. And it also attempts to mitigate the risk of unplanned work ending up in post. A common saying by our production partners is that when there are issues, everything will get fixed in post. That might work for individual productions, but when you're producing 1,000 shows around the world, it gets prohibitively expensive. The effort to the right is an algorithmic tiering effort where productions are automatically classified into distinct tiers based on the complexity of shots and production spend on the title in a region. This is used to support slate level estimating, planning, and forecasting in several key areas around cost, scheduling, staffing, and vendor engagement to ensure that that Netflix as a studio is able to appropriately allocate resource to ensure that every production in a slate of shows could hit their launch date. Now that I've talked a bit about some of the use cases we have in the studio production domain, I'll be turning this over to Aman as we turn over the media to the creative production space.
Awesome. Thank you, Dao. So once the production and VFX tasks are done, music and effects are done, the sounding system is done, then the next steps will be on the creation of the artwork and promotional assets, such as trailers and promotional assets in general. We localize the content into the preferred languages. We make sure that there is no any technical quality issues associated with the content, and then we deploy our assets into our service. That's the general summary of what happens on the creative production space. But let's dig deep into each detail. So after post-production, our partners need to deliver the media assets into our ecosystem. Those media assets include streaming assets such as IMF and archival assets such as Locked Cut. Our teams in the editorial creative space start working on metadata of the title. They will create tags for the content. Basically, they will create descriptive information of the content that would help discover the title for our members. Once the content is tagged, it's categorized into collections, which then shows up as rows of collections on the product service. Tagging is an initiative that happens throughout the pitch-to-play pipeline. We have pre-greenlight tagging, post-greenlight tagging, and pre-launch tagging. The tags that are created during these different phases, they are leveraged through different spaces in the pitch-to-play pipeline. Tags basically are used to create content and analytic attributes such as verticals, programming category, content category, and analytic genre. Tags also power our content demand modeling predictions that are used in the key and critical decision-making process. Once all of the tags are set, and then we start working on ratings. Our content is available globally, and every country have their own sensitivity and guidelines on what kind of content to kind of show in each country. So it's important that the ratings we create is accurate in order to maintain the trust of our members. Ratings along with synopsis, they appear on the display page. If you go to the Netflix app, you'll see them next to each other. The synopsis is basically a short description of the content. It has to be compelling, and it should be able to help our member in order to decide if the given content is, you know, good for them or not. On the localization space, we basically translate the content into the preferred languages. What that means is that when we translate the content, there is a lot of nuances and details that need to happen there. We make sure that we're translating into the target language with cultural adaptation. We have to make sure that, you know, the inflection and tone is in check in order to maintain the creative feel and intent of the original language. Localization has a couple of aspects. We localize the main content. What that means is we basically create secondary audio or dubs, and we create time text assets such as subtitles. In addition to subs and dubs, we also create accessibility assets such as audio description. These are audio files that are expected to help the visually impaired people. We also have another aspect of localization. We call it product localization. We localize the main UI strings. We localize the legal documents, messaging, and customer service. In this phase, we also localize synopsis and artwork. That being said about localization, how do we choose into what language we need to localize a given asset to? As you can see in this diagram, our colleagues, our data science colleagues, that data scientists and our colleagues in different orgs, they help us create this pipeline. They create ML models to kind of forecast how a title is going to perform when it is on service ahead of launch. So during the green light and licensing phase, we know how a title is going to perform on service using the forecast model output. In addition to the forecast model output, we have some metrics and, we have some metrics that we collect about the estimated metadata of the content. Those metrics include runtime, analytic genre, to which buying team the content belongs to. A combination of the forecast model output and the estimated metadata is used then to kind of recommend to which language the given asset needs to be localized to. So the main task of the data engineering team on the creative production and studio is to enable this end-to-end pipeline, kind of building the data pipeline to power and support the different machine learning algorithms used in this stage. So starting from production, we have created the content. We worked on VFX. We created artwork and video for promotional assets. We localized the content into our preferred language. We also have created a lot of metadata about the content. So before we deploy the content into live on service, we have to make sure that, the video that we created is, playing seamlessly. The audio, sounds as the creators intended. The subtitles and time text assets that are created are accurate and in sync with each other. For that, we have automated systems that help us with quality control. So as you can see in these images, these are some of the things that we catch during the QC process. There is a diffusion frame in reflection on the top right left corner. On the top right, there is a light stand within the image that you can see in here. There's also a tape mark on the ground. We don't want to have this on service while we deploy our media assets into production. This is another example that has a dead pixel in it. And poor exposure in here. Is there too much light or there is no light at all? So some of the issues that we catch in the QC process. So before we kind of pass a given media asset through QC, we have this pipeline. This is a short summary of the pipeline. There is a lot of details behind the scenes, but once the media asset is ready for QC, we pass it through an evaluation mechanism. There is a machine learning algorithm that helps us with tiering. So we evaluate the level of QC that we need to apply on the media asset. Based on the output of that model, we know if we want to go through zero QC or not. And then if we are going through QC, it triggers a QC request for that media asset. The QC request then triggers another algorithm. We call it auto-inspection algorithm. What this is basically, algorithmically, we try to find the issues that are within the media asset before we give it into our operators that manually work on checking frame by frame on the media assets. So the output of the auto inspection algorithm is provided as a feedback to the people who manually check on the media assets. So once our operators make sure that there is no issue with the content, then the media asset is accepted. Otherwise, we will ask redelivery of the asset from our partners. So as you can see in here, this is pretty much almost the end of the pipeline. Once the media asset is accepted and ready to go, we basically encode and generate the streaming and the streams and the images that need to be uploaded into the different servers. So now we have launched our content into our service. As you can see, once the content is live on service, on some devices, we allow our members to give us some feedback for the type of issues they see on the content. So for example, in here, if you go on web, on the top right corner, you have the ability to provide a feedback with issues associated with the content. So there could be different types of issues with the content. It could be buffering and loading issue. Most of the time, this issue is in relation to the internet connectivity of our members, but sometimes they see blurry images with the content. It could be an issue with subtitle and captions. There could be typos introduced with the subtitles, or the subtitle could be out of sync with the audio. There could be an issue with audio and video. What this means is the audio and video are not in sync with each other, or there is no audio at all, or the video is not showing. Any type of issue they see on the content, our members will submit as feedback. So we listen to the feedback from our members. We aggregate the data that we get from our members and enrich it with other data set in our data warehouse. We feed this feedback data into an issue scoring model. The issue scoring model basically returns the predicted issue type for that comment based on the feedback we get from our members. The predicted issue type, along with other data sets, is then pushed into another upstream service, an aggregator service. So based on the volume of issues that we get from our members, as well as the severity of the issues, this process then triggers another QC pipeline. So now that we know the feedback and the issues that are getting from our members, we can kind of connect it to our QC pipeline. The QC pipeline then triggers a redelivery of the fixed asset from our members, from our partners. Once the media asset is fixed, we redeploy it back into our server, thereby improving the experience of our members. This is the end of the creative production stage of the pitch to play pipeline. DAO will walk us through the next stages of the studio data engineering infrastructure. Back to you, DAO.
Thank you, Aman. So now that you have the taste of our world where we have tried to make the convergence of cutting edge technology along with meticulous data collection to make our pitch to play process more efficient. This might seem like an overwhelming amount of work to manage. One vision that we're currently exploring for the future, and please brace yourself, is something like this, where we envision that the data foundation that we built could be used to power horizontal machine learning services, which will enable faster algorithm innovation in specific phases of the pitch to play pipeline. We also want to enable the cross-pollination of ideas throughout the whole content production process. And with that, we think a more platformic approach with horizontal services backing the vertical components would really help make this possible. And with that, I want to thank you for listening, and also just a huge shout out to all of our various analytics engineering, data science, and algo engineering partners, whose guidance, without of which, we would not be able to do any of this. And with that, thank you.